Right, as a reminder, we're currently in the 2 budget hearing. It is very unusual, and we take some exceptions, and particularly of everybody addresses what it wants, and we're probably going to take it that this is regarding the 2 budget. So, please.
Maybe indirectly, I don't know. My name's Stephanie Siegel, and I apologize for coming up a second time, but there were things that a couple of people said that brought something else to my mind that others may not realize. By going to a 6-hour day instead of a 7-hour day, I understand that it will cut the budget quite a bit. And I don't know if people realize that we probably stand to lose more than 20 teachers by reducing our outgoing money. But not only will we be losing these teachers, we are going to be losing the classes that they take. A couple of people have talked about choices and career paths, and a lot of these choices won't be there. People turn some of these choices into their careers, as far as auto repair, as far as culinary arts, and different things like that that we offer, robotics, engineering, things like that. So they need to realize we won't have the choices when we go to a 6-hour day that we have now. We will lose a lot of choices, and they won't just be fluff-up classes. Many of them, I'm sure, will be some of these classes that students turn into lifelong careers. It's not just fluff classes.
We are told that we have the opportunity to become greater than what we plan on being. Having 7 hours a day, I have found more classes, I have found more opportunities in life that I would like to go and prosper. I found culinary arts, photography, and medical. Now, taking away 7 hours, I not only lose my language class, which will take away bilingualism in my future career, which decreases me in money for my family that I plan to have. So I lose money then. I also lose the opportunity to take culinary arts next year. So either I have to choose between culinary arts and 2 hours, or I have to choose between photography and Spanish next year. Now, it has also come to my understanding that Spanish 4 and higher may be decreased, and the elective classes of photography and arts may also be decreased because of the teachers being laid off. Now, I will lose another career path doing that. I also have a plan of going into culinary arts my sophomore junior year and going into medical opposition my junior and senior year. Taking away my 7 hours will decrease me in that choice. It will also decrease me of the possibility of being able to save money going into college by taking these classes. When I take medical opposition in my second year, I will be able to have an internship. Taking that away from me, I will have to pay more money going into college. Now, what I understand is that elementary school, you learn the basics, middle school prepares you for high school prepares you for the rest of your life. Now, with this Chinese program that I heard earlier about Chinese teachers also teaching American teachers in younger grades, it tells me that you're giving more opportunities to the kids that really don't need that opportunity at that age, and taking away from the kids that are getting ready to go on with the rest of their life. Now, to me, that really doesn't make sense. I've also discovered that you have laid off one of the very important teachers. That takes away a sporting event for me, it takes away a class for me, and it also ruins her. She has a family that she just started, and you take away money for her. Now, I'm just saying that by you taking away my 7 hours, you're taking away my life choices and many others around me. I think that we should be able to have the choice of what we want to do, and by you guys just taking this and making it 6 hours, and I know you say that it's not final yet, but saying that you're cutting these classes tells us all that it's already final. Now, I'm sure you all had the opportunity to have the chance to be where you are today. Taking away those hours from us is taking away our opportunity to become what we want. I'd be more excited if they would come back.
As a reminder, later in our meeting, we will have the opportunity to discuss after the presentation of the 6-hour day of overloading 7-hour day. There will be an opportunity to comment. We are currently in the budget hearing. Please, sir.
Staff members, you want time. You don't need to keep going again.
I will chair this meeting as I do. Thank you very much.
Let the kids talk.
Dawson, it's a long job. First off, I want to say that this isn't really about me as a person. A 6-hour day doesn't apply to me. My whole life I've been trying to become an actor, and so far 6-hour days still works in my schedule. I don't apply for this, but I came here more because not just for the people that I see here currently in this crowd who go from my school, or the people that I see in this crowd who run my school. I know that on a 6-hour day, that you have to make tough choices, but that you can still progress into a college where you can make yourself better. On a 7th-hour day, you can do the same thing. Although, looking at the time differences and having extra classes, you do these possibilities of making new friends, having new experiences, and with exploratories from my own personal view, I've realized that exploratories usually are when you make more friends than normal. My acting class, I've been with them like the entire year. It's an exploratory, so it really doesn't matter. And it was with Mr. Albert, who's been cut this year. So I'm not going to be in that acting class. So I'm going to command that now for Mr. Erickson's acting class. So it doesn't really apply to me. But after I get in that class, I go to a strong bond with these people. And that's all I can really tell you about how the 7-hour day differs from the 6-hour. Doesn't apply to me, but I feel that there are a lot of students that I have walked around with, and personally, as a member of the student council at my school, which I absolutely love my school, I'll be honest. It's the only school I can truly say that I've ever liked. There may be people who start bad things and do bad things, but that's a given. We're all humans. We all do that stuff. Daily life in a different way. But, the main thing that I've realized is you're the school board of education, you know. You're the head guys, you make decisions, but I mean, everyone still has a boss, so that's really. So, I mean, I can't put all the pressure on you guys. Nobody in this room can honestly say that they don't have a boss. So, all the pressure can't be anything. And, but what I want to pose, I guess you can say, is as a member of the student council at my school and somebody who has a perfect attendance, I've never seen you guys ever in my life. And I like to believe that I'm friends with Mr. Stanley and Ms. Brady, my dean, and one of my vice principals. And I walk around in the office a lot, and I mean, I know everybody by first and last name. I'm really involved with my schooling and education, and I truly care about that, which is something that might take a lot of people in my school by surprise. The thing that I would just want to propose is my school bus members, very, very dedicated. So, I don't know what your guys' average on a day-to-day work schedule looks like, but if it is anything like our normal school day, I think it would really help our school to feel more comfortable with the decisions that you guys are making. If it felt more like a democracy, if at least one, two, all of you guys were to show up at the schools and met with the student council, because as somebody who represents all these people there, I feel like I'm kind of letting them down, because when people complain to me about executive decisions and things that they have no power over, and they're complaining about it, doing that, and I know I'm supposed to be representing them. I signed up for this. I wrote essays for this. I worked really hard at this. I maintained good grades for them, and I didn't do anything against it. I feel as if the student council is just pointless at that point. Because we don't do as much as we should. We don't reach out as much as we should from what I've been seeing. But as what this is trying to show is that school board is more democratic, kind of feels like key point communism. Thank you. All the decisions.
Thank you very much for coming. Can I also thank you?
Now, you mentioned that the 5.7% is too close to 5% when we have state and location. Might I ask what number you are shooting for?
Well, I believe, and Rochelle can answer this better, the recommendation for a fund balance, I believe, is about 12% for a pardon? Our policy is 5%, but as far as recommendations, 5 to 10%. As far as recommendations for operations from companies that say on what we should be operating at, I believe it's more like 12%. Part of what I don't, you know, we heard different terms thrown around, but at a point we start borrowing money and paying payroll. That we have a large payroll. That is what this district does. We have staff that spend a lot of time working with students. We heard that from our students. In order to make payroll, our payment to experts and all those things, we have to have so much. Any company, I mean, this is basic business, has an operating fund. And in order to provide those services, you don't have to pay out sick time and do these things. You need so much cash on hand. So the answer, you know, typically the state has a standard of 5%, where they have set that, where the state treasury department starts coming in and saying, and reviewing your books, and saying, start saying, looking at your procedures, and giving you help, is their
I understand. I guess I'm just trying to see exactly what the numbers are, because I've heard some numbers thrown out from people that are coming to my. So if you would like to be over 5.7%, I wanted to know what the goal is, and I would like to know what the number is, the dollar figure that you're trying to save, I guess, by laying off these teachers. I'd like to know what that number is. I would like to know how many teachers that translates into, and I would like to know what that's going to do to the class sizes. I'm sure all these things have been looked at, and as a parent and a taxpayer and one of the people that probably elected you, I would like to know what those numbers are. Because if you're going to pull teachers out of the school and leave the same number of students there, those bodies have to go somewhere. This is going to impact. I would like to know what the figures are.
When we saw the assumptions tonight, what was built in, and I'm Michelle, probably I'm wrong, but when you saw those assumptions that were presented to you, that takes those figures into account. So those are the projections if implementing the proposed budget and what we're looking at. So what you saw tonight is that there's a couple other questions you asked in there, and I agree with you, the class sizes would increase.
How much?
It's a very amount.
Of course, it's very good. No one has any idea. Ten more people in class.
So this not only increases your choices, but it also increases the class sizes substantially. You have to start one class the whole day. So you're taking 30 kids and spreading them among six classes, so it's about 5 students per class, and class size of both is.
And how many teachers will we be using?
The plan right now, I think.
Order, Mr. President, we have a presentation of the, we have a recommendation later in the program on, but on the,
Answer the question.
Thank you. Yes, it depends, it is negotiated within the contract, and the size of the classes, and depending on the classes that are offered, it will be different, so there's no one figure. So that is part of what the next discussion on the budget.
There is another spot for hearing school district agents. At that time, you can speak. We need to get through this budget hearing and move on the agenda and we'll get the council to the
Linda, you're the one who wanted to say
something. It's on the agenda. Is there a motion?
I make a motion that we close the truth and budget hearing.
Is there a second? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Aye. Motion carries. Thank you. All right, next on the agenda is the approval of minutes. Is there a motion to approve the May 16, 2016 regular meeting minutes?
Support.
Is there a second?
Support.
We have a motion and support. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Is there a motion to approve the May 31st, 2016 special meeting minutes?
So moved.
Support.
We have a motion to support. Any discussion on the motion?
I will be recusing myself as I am the
Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Next on the agenda is a presentation of the high school 6th grade day.
Thank you. You know, we have obviously had a little bit of discussion about this already, but it is, you know, it's an important topic, and I've really been impressed by the level of passion on this issue. It is very clear that our community wants only the best for their kids. They want their kids to have every opportunity available to them. And, you know, why not? I mean, we all want to make sure our kids, you know, have everything that they can have, and certainly more than we had. And for the kids, I think as I hear your level of commitment to your education and how hard you're willing to work, and how deep of thinkers you are about your future, I admire you. I mean, what I hear, I think I'm speaking for all of us probably, you know, your passion for education and your commitment to your future and making sure it's what you envision for yourself is amazing. So that's fantastic, and it is great to have an opportunity to hear this. This, I think, was an important part of the process. There are other conversations that need to happen, and that's why we wanted to make a presentation out of this in addition to the comments that people want to share. There's, you know, more voices that need to be brought in, more things to consider in the story. Because as we've talked about this a little bit, we have almost 11,000 kids here, about 10,500 kids. And we certainly don't have that number of kids and families in this room. Not surprisingly, as a public education entity, we have such diversity among people's expectations, what they expect to get from their education, you know, what they want, what they feel like they need. We are trying to meet the needs of, you know, 10,500 very diverse kids and their families. And it's a great conversation to have that is exactly where we should be spending our time. In addition to what we've heard here, and there are a lot of benefits to a 7-hour day, We also want to talk a little bit about what some of the benefits or some of the advantages that can occur with a six-hour day, because that needs to be a part of the conversation if we're going to have a whole conversation about this. And then a lot of you have asked us to talk a little bit about the money. I mean, you're saying, tell me about that. You know, I know everyone in this room, or pretty close to everyone in this room, was in for the beginning presentation on the budget work session. The school district, all school districts across the state of Michigan, have serious financial issues. And it occurs because of two things, primarily two things. Number one is across the state, we're losing enrollment. School districts receive money on a per pupil basis. If you lose kids, you're losing money. And you lose the revenue from students far faster than you can lose the expenses. There's lots of conversations about some costs in schools being fixed costs. So just because you're losing the kids and the revenue associated with it doesn't mean you can offset it immediately with costs. For those of you that were watching, Rochelle showed you that declining enrollment since 2010-11, we thought we've lost 1,334 students here. If you look at the foundation allowance, the amount of money we receive per pupil, if we still had those children, those 1,300 kids were still in our district, we'd have $10 million more per year annually. Now, I know, I wish you guys didn't have to think about that. That, you know, that's not what you're here for. You're here for opportunities for your kids. But you are demanding an answer, and you deserve one. So I'm doing that. So that's unfortunately one of the issues that we're dealing with. 1,300 less students than 5 years ago. And that equals $10 million. The second piece of the story is we received that amount of money, an amount of money per pupil from the state. The state dictates how much money we receive per pupil. In 2010-11, in the state's infinite wisdom, they had financial issues as well, but they decided every school district across the state of Michigan would lose $470 per pupil. It was a unilateral decision made at the state level because I guess they prioritized where they wanted to put the state budget, and K-12 public education were not winners in that discussion. Even today, as the state has slowly given us a little bit of money back, we are still below what we had in 2010-11. Now, I think all of us understand costs go up. I mean, the only thing we're not paying more for right now is gasoline, but pretty much everything else costs more money in our homes everywhere. But even though that is true, we are getting less per pupil than we did back in 2010-11. So it's just the reality. To the tune of $2.5 million annually, that's what that represents today. $10 million less based on enrollment, about $2.5 million annually because of the change in the foundation allowance, less than we had back in 2010-11. Now, we have been doing a combination, and I apologize because I am saying some things more than once, so I apologize for that. But we have over the years been trying to address our budget issues through a combination of using some fund balance, because you hate to take away any programs or services for kids and families, so using a bit of our fund balance, and then also making some reductions. So in the past 3 years, we've made a total of $7.8 million worth of budget reductions. $7.8 million. But then we've also depleted our fund balance to pretty much the base. We're at 5.7, we're saying 5% is the point of no return. So we are into a place of trying to look always at how we best meet the needs of all of our students while living within our budget. There is no more savings account to get them to. So this issue is about whether we can provide the high quality program and services for kids, for our high school kids, on a 6 hour day. There's a lot of reasons, there's good reasons why 6 hours makes sense for a lot of kids. Although I certainly have heard loud and clear, not the families that are represented here and perhaps some that aren't represented. But for a lot of people, 6 hours works. And so part of what we want to do is, one, acknowledge the 7 hour day and what it means to everybody. Because, again, it's impressive. You guys are passionate, and we love that you're passionate about school. We want to talk about what the six-hour benefits can be. We want to talk about how we believe, we hope, we can meet the needs of both groups. And that's the goal of this presentation, is to just get a few more voices in the room on this issue. And again, there's public comment after, so all voices get to be heard. But we want We want to make sure to do that. Thank you very much. So with that, let's do that. So with that, I would like to ask Lisa Montrestis, who is our Assistant Superintendent of Instruction, to begin the conversation.
The first thing I would like to do is invite our
Yes, very welcome first. Thank you. Good evening, Andrew Familli, Board of Education and Superintendent Johnson. For those of you out here that don't know me, my name is Steve Chopsky, and I'm the principal of Longstreet High School. I was asked tonight to say a few words regarding this challenge and change. So tonight I'd like to take an opportunity to remind everyone about the importance of our community here in Las Cruz. I did this at graduation last week, and I think I need to do it again, because we need to stand together and get through these good times as well as the challenging ones. Our sense of community should be filled with cooperation rather than competitiveness, pitting one course of study against another is simply not acceptable within our community. It's divisive, and it encourages conflict and resentment. Tonight I wanted to provide everybody with my perspective on education, because I think it's broad. It's not as in-depth as Dr. Dixon. I don't have those initials after my name. But I attended parochial schools K through 12. I earned 3 university degrees. I taught down south at one of the best preparatory academies in the country. I also worked for a number of years in the Detroit Public Schools. Along with that, I've worked the past 6 years at Las Cruz High School, 5 of the last 6 as principal. Those experiences didn't provide me with any type of knowledge or scientific research in support of a 5, 6, 7, or 8-hour day. It simply didn't. And I continue to hear this question, is what's best for kids? Well, I can tell you from my educational experience down south with the richest of the rich, the smartest of the smart, with a tough urban school district, that my experience tells me that the Las Cruz Public Schools is not a good place for kids, it's a great place for kids. And it's not just because of our great schools, there's a lot of great schools. What separates us is our sense of community and our closeness. All of this tonight is your passion for education, and that's good. There's not a person in here that doesn't want each and every one of you to be passionate about school. From parents to children to teachers to administrators to board members to superintendents. I guess as the building principal, I'm asking all of you for a little bit of patience on the south end of town. We're working all summer. We will get the 6-hour day put together. We will do our best to make sure 100% of our students have as many courses that they request that they would like. But I need time to do my job. I'm just simply asking all of you, if you can give me time to do my job, if you'd like to meet with me, my door is always open. I'm here all day, in Fort Huron all weekend for softball and baseball. This is what we do. You know, I live in the community, same place all of you. I'm an advocate for our kids to just like you. So the last thing I would do is let anything happen to them that would negatively impact their education.